Okay, so thanks for this slot. Unfortunately, I'm replacing Alberto Bufanti that was not able to come to Seattle. So we are the idea was to present an NPDF 3.1, which is the latest release of an NPDF. So let's start from again from the definition of PDF that we saw this morning. So PDFs are the essential ingredient that is used when computing hadronic cross-sections. And thanks to the factorization theorem, we can write observables in terms of the convolution between the hard cross-section and the PDF. PDFs are not calculable, so you need to extract the structure from the data by doing a fit. So usually PDFs, if you plot in as a function of the momentum fraction, and for the different flavors, they look like this distribution. So for each single flavor, you have a shape, and we have also an uncertainty band to estimate. PDFs are connected to different energy scales by the Dirichlet evolution equations, and so that's why you see the different behavior at a lower energy, at 10 GeV squared, and here at 10 to the 4 GeV squared. The NNPDF approach is based on 2 points, so the use of the motion of all bias, possible theoretical bias, due to the choice of a parametric form, so you would have no fixed functional form, and we have also the possibility to reproduce a non-Gaussian behavior. This is quite important because many people that use polynomials and fixed functional forms, they do not take into account, they symmetrize everything, and the data and the fit is always Gaussian due to the methodology. So for in order to satisfy this point, we use neural networks instead of polynomials. And the second important point is the way that we propagate uncertainties. So we propagate uncertainties from the experimental data, and we also take into account the minimization inefficiency and the generated mean. And we are also trying to integrate the theoretical uncertainties. For now, we don't include the theoretical uncertainties like the alpha strong values, the quark masses, but we deliver several PDF sets with different setups. So again, just a quick summary, quick simplified overview that you saw this morning. The steps to generate an NPDF are very concise here. So we generate artificial pseudo data replicas using a Monte Carlo bootstrap. And then for each Monte Carlo bootstrap, we fit the PDFs using neural networks through a genetic algorithm. And this genetic algorithm is controlled by a training validation method, which controls the chi-square value. And when you reach the minimum of the validation, we stop. At the end of this procedure, we get a Monte Carlo representation of results. So we have a Monte Carlo replica. This is the gluon PDF at initial scale. And with these replicas, we can evaluate the central value by computing the average and the uncertainty by using standard deviation or the 68 confidence interval. More details. For NNPDF 3.1, we parameterize the neural networks in two different bases. So we have the standard basis used by everybody and before, let's say, 2017, is the perturbative charm. So we have 7 flavors, the gluon, the singlet, the valence, and the triplets. So no charm. The charm PDF is generated through the Dirichlet. And now, since the last few months, we have included the charm PDF. So we included the C+ parameterization. As I told you, we use the look-back stopping criteria. So when the validation reaches the minimum, we get these parameters and we use these parameters as the final PDF setup. All the procedure is tested and validated through the closure tests. So in a closure test, we take an input PDF, which can be whatever, can be an NPDF or another PDF set like MCW, CTEC. We generate artificial data replicas. We apply our methodology to see if we get exactly the same input as before. And if this cycle, this scheme is complete, then we validate, and you see that all our choices are not biasing the procedure. So we are sure that there is nothing missing in this setup. So what about an NPDF 3.1? Why we have this release that was published last month? So if you see the timeline, so our last release was at the end of 2014, was an NPDF 3.0, and then we worked for 2 years trying to accumulate data and checking the setup, checking the optimizations of our setup. But meanwhile, we get some other project like an NPDF 3.0 with a threshold resumation, large X threshold resumation, an NPDF with intrinsic charm, which is in the way we included the charm PDF, and an NPDF 3.0 with QED effects, with the Photon PDF. And now we are here with an NPDF 3.1. But in some sense, the 3.1 is the last global PDF feature that the community see. Because you see NPDF 3.0, MMHT, and CTEC, and we are at the end of 2016. This is the first set with new data from LHC version 2. Motivations. So, first motivation, new data. So, LHC data collected between 2011 and 12. And we have also a new NNLO QCD population, so we have the K factors to perform a full NNLO fit. And finally, we have the new technology to fit the charm PDF, following the NNPDF 3 intrinsic charm studies published in this paper. Everything that I'm showing here is published in this archive paper, published just a couple of months in June. And you can see, I'll show you some of the most interesting plots for this release. Just one parenthesis about the framework. So NNPDF has several pieces of public codes. No? The most relevant for PDF fitting is the upfill grid, which is a fast technology to perform convolutions. As you imagine we have 30,000 interactions to perform with the genetic algorithm, and in each interaction we compute, we evaluate theoretical predictions for more than 4,000 data points. So this is extremely time consuming, so we need to have a tool which boosts these computations as much as possible. And then together with this set of PDFs, we applied all the reduction strategies that I showed this morning in order to reduce the size of the sets. So we are fitting 1,000 replicas, but we are delivering always 100 replicas in both representations, in Monte Carlo and in Hesh. Right, just an example when I talked about the fast convolutions. So upfill grid is a combination of upfill, which is a PDF evolution library, with the APPL grid technology. It's something similar to what we have seen before with Daniel. But the difference is that we not only look at the weight of the process, but we modify the weight in order to take into account the DGLAP evolution. So we pre-evaluate the DGLAP, and then we attach to the weight. So then our fitting procedure has just to multiply to perform this convolution multiplication as fast as possible. And here you have some timings about this table, so we call upfill grid or FK tables. Using the setup. So usually if you take the pure APPL grid, which is what experiments and Monte Carlos deliver, this is the convolution time per point in microseconds for different process. This is the Darien process again. So you see the black points. But if you introduce the DGLAP kernels inside of the tables, then you drop this time to the blue squares. And if you use specific assembly optimizations like AVX, then you can go further and further. And if you do OpenMP plus AVX, you can reach up to 100 times faster convolutions instead of pure end-to-pool convolution. So, and this kind of performance is very important because then our fits will take approximately 20 hours instead of months. Okay, so the 3.1 settings, now we have the motivation. What is the difference between the past? Is the inclusion of these data sets. So we have Electric Productions from Atlas and CMS from 2011. We have JETS from Atlas at 7 dB, and also JETS from CMS at 2.76. They are very important to large medium gluon X constraints. Then you have Atlas low mass Drellian and CMS low and high mass Drellian. And finally, Atlas double differential ZPT. Same for the CMS. We have, apart from the electro reproduction, the TT bar differential cross sections for Atlas and CMS, and the LHCb WNZ rapidity distributions, plus the D0 legacy double symmetry from Peloton. So as you see, the date of measurement is they have been performed between 2011 and 12, and they constrain almost all the partons in the medium large X region. So in total, these new data points are around 300 points, and on top of the 3.0. So if you look at the kinematical plot, this is the current situation for 3.1 as a function of X. So we cover almost all the X range from 10 to the minus 4 up to 1, and the Q square values go from very few GV, from 5-10 GV, to very high values, which are the JET data here. The total number of data points, they change depending on the perturbative order of the fit, but we are fluctuating around 4,200. So if you take the NNLO, 285. This number changes because we apply different cuts and criteria to include the data points in order to avoid issues with higher twists at low Q and so on and so forth. Theoretical predictions are computed with FAPF for deep and elastic scattering and fixed target Drellian. And for the hadronic data, we use AVL grid and fast NLO are attached to MCFM, MCF NLO, NLO Jet Plus Plus, depending on the process. And at an NLO, we computed the key factors, and you use key factors for these fits. Just a parenthesis about the key factors. The key factors for, we have these two important key factors, one for the top pair production. These numbers have been computed with the Chacon recent paper, this paper, and also continued by the other with Hartland and Arroyo. And the ZPT double differential distributions have been computed by Petriello and Bugesal, and cross-checked by also by German, the reader. And we have added these scale factors together with uncorrelated theory errors for them, because they fluctuate a little bit. JET, inclusive JET cross-sections are also available, but unfortunately they published the paper only for one data set, and we are not able to include them for all the missing six. So we prefer the JET to keep extra correlated theory uncertainties due to scale variation, and then cross-check the results and see what happens. Now, results. In terms of chi-square, the quality of the fit is quite good at an NLO. We have the chi-squares individually by experiment groups, but the total, if you see, with a fitted charm is 1.15. And if you do perturbative charm, it deteriorates a little bit. So the fit prefers the charm, the fitted charm. And if you look at the NLO, the situation is the same, so the relative values are the same, but our best evaluation is always at an NLO, so 1.148. So we have a very good description of the collider measurements, and the charm PDF seems really necessary in order to get better results. Now, to understand if during these 2 years what happened, if it's just data or if it's data plus methodology, you can look at these plots where we compare the 3.1 gluon PDF, down PDF, S plus, and S and charm plus, and you compare the 3.1 to the 3.1 fit using the 3.0 data. So if you look at the green versus the red, you are measuring how the data has changed with fixed methodology. So you see that there are some differences for the gluon at large X, but in general, the distributions are quite compatible with U1 sigma. And if you look at the blue curve, which is an MPDF 3.0, you see that the difference to the red is small, and this is mainly due to the charm PDF. So we have included a new PDF pattern, changed the structure of the prediction, so it changed a little bit, but this is really a small, a tiny effect in comparison to the data. In terms of uncertainty, if you computed the luminosity, the two-dimensional luminosity, so here you have rapidity versus the invariant mass, an MPDF 3.0 is in this first column, and an MPDF 3.1, the new set, is on the right column. You see that the uncertainties, this is the relative uncertainty, is much smaller in comparison to the past release. So now here at the large X region, our uncertainties are touching 1%, and before it was around 5%. For all different channels. So this first row are gluon-gluon luminosities. The second row you have a quarter gluon luminosity. So we improve a lot the central and high X region. The most relevant modification, change, and let's say the most important, the data that we have included is really really focused on the gluon PDF. So if you look at it, by adding and removing data, you see that it's quite stable, but the top data is the one which is really modifying a lot of the structure of the gluon at large X. So it shifts the values, but in general it's quite compatible. Even if you remove jets, the structure of the gluon is stable, and this is because all these three, the top, the ZPT and the jet data, are interconnected and are constraining the gluon at large X. And this is quite good, because then the gluon PDF uncertainty drops, and we get a nice luminosities and nice PDF uncertainties for them. Another result is the charm content of the proton. So if you computed the charm momentum fraction, then you can see that at the charm mass, the 3.1 feet has a momentum fraction which is below 1%, so 0.26 plus minus 42. If you add the EMC data, which is a special data set with F2 charm, we can reduce this uncertainty first, but it has always less than 1% momentum fraction. And this is the shape of the charm plus distribution and the ratio between these setups. Now, if you compare the luminosity of an MPDF 3.1 to the global PDF that are available, so an MPDF 3.1 versus CTEC 14 and MHT 14, you see that they are compatible for the quark-quark, for quark-anti-quark, gluon-gluon, and quark-gluon. So in the region where we have the data, they are okay, they are compatible. We have some difference at the extrapolation region, as usual, at large X. And if you start checking the theoretical predictions for the WNZ production and you compare to data, so the data is represented by this blue area, the data plus uncertainty, you see that the 3.1 is really on top of the measurements from Atlas, in this case for W plus, W minus, and for W plus and Z, and for all the three families for the ratio. So you see that always NPF is really close to 3.0 to the real data. And finally, if you look at the Higgs cross sections, you see that for gluon initiated process, the 3.1 and 3.0 are quite close, while for quark initiated, an NPF 3.1 tends to provide larger values for the cross sections, and this is due to the fact that the collider data prefers larger values. And in all cases, you can see that the uncertainties of 3.1 are much smaller in comparison to the previous determinations. Okay, so this is my summary. We have presented MPDF 3.1. We have included all the available new data from the past 2 years, in particular the ZPT data, the electric production measurements, and the top quark production. We observed an improvement of all PDFs uncertainties. We have also seen that the inclusion of the charm PDF improves the quality of our results. And if you are interested in seeing all the PDF sets and using them, you can visit this webpage, where you have all the LHAPD assets available, and you have also a gallery of plots with many other informations about the NPS 3.0. Okay, thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Stefano. Questions, comments, remarks?
So you have a piece that you picture for the neural network.
Yes.
So then the results for the why, where does that come from? How do you justify that?
Well, but at the beginning, we tested we use this deep search. We have tried the different architectures. But usually what happens is that PDFs are very smooth. They are very smooth functions. So usually a multi-layer perceptron with relatively small architecture is fine, so you can get that with it. The main problem of PDFs is that we have physical constraints. For example, if you looked at this, you see here, when you go to x equal 1, the PDF must go to 1. To 0, sorry. And then depending on the flavor, at small x, it can explode or it can converge to 0. And here you need to apply preprocessing. And sometimes the preprocessing can destroy the structure and the smoothness of your red. So you have to control and randomize as much as possible. Yeah. So you use this and that's it.
Now on your second slide, I believe it was, you mentioned something about the theoretical bias.
Yes.
And so it leads to the thought that maybe you can get rid of that bias, but that's not the case, right?
No, it is.
You still have bias with the neural network itself.
No, but you can, if you tell the story in this way, it seems the case. But if you check, for example, if you do closure tests with pseudo replicas in the extrapolation region, you can see that these kind of models are much less biased than the usual polynomials.
Right.
So the problem is that the community that we have now is really, every time you see a new release of this polynomial-based PDFs, they are just changing randomly the Chebyshev or the order of the polynomial.
Right.
And they never understand what is going on. Just the assumption, you want a shape like this, so that's it. So in this way, you try to avoid as much as possible this.
More questions? That seems not to be the case, so thanks again for this talk. Now we come to the final talk this session.